it's a product for home, business, or industry, you can be sure if it's Westinghouse. Tonight, Westinghouse welcomes you to its premier presentation of Studio One.
Get on them, gamblers. I gotta refuel.
How you doing, Ned?
I rolled a fine run of sevens on the second throw. Paul upstairs?
Yeah, come in half an hour ago. One of the boys just brought in tomorrow morning's Observer. This Taylor Henry has let off a fair blast of wind against Paul.
Let me see.
Sure. That young lad's making quite a crusade against the forces of evil in this fair city of ours. And because Paul's political boss, he's nominated him public enemy number one. If he keeps this up, he'll run clean out of adjectives before November.
You mind if I borrow this, Mike?
Help yourself.
Hey.
Oh, hi, Ned. Come in. Sit down. What do you want?
Oh, a couple of hundred.
Craps?
Yeah.
Much of a game tonight?
Pee-wee.
It's a long time since you've been on the winning end, isn't it?
Oh, not so long. A month, 6 weeks.
That's a long time to be losing, isn't it?
Not for me.
Okay. As long as you can stand the gaff.
I can stand anything I gotta stand.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess you can at that.
Oh, thanks.
Matter of fact, I'm glad you dropped in tonight, Ned. I've been trying to make up my mind about something. You ought to be able to help me out.
That's what you pay me for, isn't it?
Yeah, but you know more about this sort of stuff than I do. Janet Henry's birthday is tomorrow. What do you think I ought to give her?
Why should you give her anything?
Two reasons. In the first place, she's the senator's daughter. In the second place, I like her. Yeah, I like her a lot.
Well, I hope she likes you better than her brother does.
Taylor? He's just a young squirt fresh out of college, thinks he's got to reform the world. He's harmless.
Maybe, maybe not. You, seen the early edition of The Observer?
No, why?
Maybe you should. Like it?
No. That's not the question. What do I give Miss Henry?
Are you going to back her father in the election?
I think we will, yes.
Why?
Because with us behind him, we'll snow Kennedy under. He won't have a chance. We'll put over the whole ticket.
Even with his son taking you apart every day in the Observer?
I tell you, the old man will muzzle in any time I give the word. And, Ned, if he don't, I will.
How would the senator do without you?
Wouldn't have a chance.
Does he know that?
How could he help it? I wouldn't be going there for dinner tomorrow night if he didn't.
Well, I'm glad you know that much, at least. Do you think he'll play ball with you after the election?
I can take care of him.
Maybe. Don't forget, he's never been licked at anything in his life.
One of the best reasons I know for throwing in with him.
No, it's not. It's the very worst. Think that over, even though it hurts your head.
Now, how far has this dizzy blonde daughter of his got her hooks into you?
I'm gonna marry her.
That part of the bargain?
But nobody knows it yet, except you and me.
Well, if that's what you want, make him put it in writing. Or,
better still, insist on the wedding before election. That way you'll at least be sure of your pound of flesh.
Remember, to them you're a lower form of animal life. None of the rules apply.
I didn't ask you for all this. I asked you what kind of a present I should give Miss Henry.
Well, if you're really so witchy, why don't you give her some flowers?
Flowers?
Oh, I know. Give her a convertible or a couple of yards of pearls. Well, there's time enough for that. Start little. Grow.
Well, maybe you're right.
Yes, I am.
Well, I can't say I like it.
What?
Flowers it is.
And not too many of them.
The boy's been getting restless ever since you threw in with the senator. They got a feeling you don't care about protecting them anymore. They've started to call on Shadow Rory for favors.
So what?
Well, you know, the Shab's been trying to grab your spot for years. This is his big chance. With Taylor Henry's help, he's got the outsiders figuring that you're a racketeer, while the insiders think that maybe they can do better with Shad than with you since you started playing post office with a senator and his blonde daughter.
Yes, but Ned, this is one time I'm way ahead of you. Now, you know the Shad's been getting out of line for some time. That's why I gave the order to have Mr. O'Rourke knocked loose from our little city. Word went out before noon to Rainey to close up the doghouse in the Paradise Gardens and any other joint that Shad or any of his friends have an interest in. Two of the biggest were smeared tonight. And we're going to knock the rest of them over in one long row starting tomorrow.
I don't like it.
Why not?
It's like using a cyclone shot to blow off a safe door.
Well, I never could learn to box, Ned. The only time I tried, I got licked. It's too late now, anyway. We're giving Mr. O'Rourke the cyclone shot.
Have it your own way, Paul. I still say it's wrong.
Yeah, come in. Oh, what is it, Mike?
Shad just walked in, Paul. Jeff and Whiskey are with him.
Who's around?
Steve's on the door. I got Walt and Harry standing by.
Good. Send O'Rourke in. Have two guys watch the stairs, Mike, but send O'Rourke in alone. Okay. Now, Ned, we're gonna see who's right.
Maybe. Maybe not. With Lowe?
No. Come on, stick around.
I'm fine, Paul. How's yourself?
Fine. No Beaumont?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Politics is politics and business is business, Paul. And I've been paying my way. And I'm willing to go on paying. But I want what I pay for.
You mean you're trying to tell me that some of your coppers won't stay bought, huh?
I mean, two coppers told me tonight their orders to smear me came straight from you.
Well, what do you think of that, Ned?
I bought protection, Paul. I want it. What's your answer?
No.
It's going to mean killing.
If you make it mean that.
It will. I'm too big to take the boot from you now.
Maybe you're too big to take it laying down, but you take it, Shad. You are taking it.
I'm opening the doghouse in Paradise Gardens tomorrow night. I don't want to be bothered. Bother me and I'll bother you.
Fine, yeah, say, how are the folks? All good. That's fine. Say, Rainey, they tell me the Shad's thinking of opening up again. Tomorrow night. Yeah. Yeah. Slam it down so hard it bounces. Right. Goodbye. Now, you understand, Shad? You understand where you sit? You're through. You're through in this town for good.
Yeah. I understand.
Well?
Wrong, Paul, wrong.
Who are you calling?
I'm gonna take those two bills of yours and lay them on a 16-to-1 shot. We'll see who guesses right. If it comes home, I'm taking my 3,200 and clearing out. Hello, Bernie. Bernie, Ned Beaumont. Look, I got 200 to lay on Peggy O'Toole on the nose. Yeah, I'm betting it's going to stop raining. On a dry track, you'll do all right. Right. Now, come on, sunshine. $3,200 worth of you.
Now that you've seen part one of The Glass Key by Dashiell Hammett, let's pause and look at our program. Are you a water saver?
Am I a water saver? Oh, well, you see, I never waste water in wash day. In fact, I can save up to 10 gallons on every load of clothes I wash, thanks to my Westinghouse laundromat. You see, this exclusive water saver saves water, and that means it saves on soap, too. Now, here's how much soap you need in an average washer. Here's how much you can save with your Westinghouse laundromat, up to 1/2 per washing. Now, if you have a small load, say, lingerie, hose, well, you won't have to use the full amount of soap and water as you would with other washers. If you have a small load, just take it from your handy loading shelf and drop it into your laundromat. No stooping, no bending. Then you set your dial for low. You add a small amount of soap, and automatically you get just the water you need. Then you set this dial like that, and your work is done. For your Westinghouse laundromat is completely automatic. It washes, it rinses, it damps dry, it even cleans itself. But see for yourself, your hands never touch water. And buy on proof.
Yes, buy on proof. Just give me a ring. I'll come out to your house and pick up a load of your clothes. Or you bring them in if you'd like and see them washed in the Westinghouse laundromat. Then you'll know why we say the wash word is laundromat.
Now we return to The Glass Key as adapted for Studio One by Worthington Miner.
Ned.
I've been worse.
Anything on your mind?
Yeah. What time do you make it?
Say 10:30. Why?
I say 10:32.
All right, so it's 10:32. So what?
I don't know. So what? I just wanted to make sure our watches agreed. How'd the Henry dinner go?
I have been at worse. Why?
Was Taylor there?
Not for dinner. Why?
He's dead in a gutter up the street about a block and a half from here.
Is that so?
Did you understand what I said?
Yes.
He was killed.
What do you want me to do, get hysterical about it?
Shall I call the police?
Don't they know about it?
There was no one around when I saw him. I just wanted to check with you before I did anything. Is it all right for me to say that I found him?
Why not?
His hat wasn't there.
He won't need it now. You're a fool, Ned.
One of us is. Peggy O'Toole came home yesterday. Remember what I said? Still goes. By the way, here's what I owe you. Hey, hello. Who's on the desk? Fletcher, let me talk to you. Hello, Bill. Ned Beaumont. Taylor Henry has been knocked off. You'll find his body in a gutter on the north side of China Street, about a half a block east of Elm. Oh, yeah. Oh, you know about it already? Good, I just thought I'd let you know. Hmm? I spotted it at 10:29. I know because I checked my watch. Okay, thanks.
I suppose you think this plays right into Aurora's hands, huh?
He's got you right like that, Paul.
So, I understand you're figuring on throwing me down and clearing out, ain't it?
Tired of hit town stuff.
Meaning me? You know you're hard to get along with, Beaumont.
Never said I wasn't.
All right. In that case, there.
You don't owe me anything.
I owe you a lot more than that, Ned. Take it.
All right. Thanks.
Just when you figuring on clearing out?
Take a couple of days to clean up.
Now, tell me one thing before you go. What's your guess on what O'Rourke will do next?
How good an alibi have you got for this evening?
Not as tight as I'd like.
Then I think he'll crucify you.
My guess is the minute he hears this news, he'll start a crime wave. And every guy who's bumped off, he'll spread the word you had it done to stop Taylor talking. He'll make the whole town believe that you killed Taylor Henry on account of his crusade was beginning to hurt, and now you're running wild to cover it up.
Maybe. But the only kind of fighting I know, Ned, is to slug it out. That's what brought me from running errands for Packy Flood in the old fifth to where I am now. And it ain't so bad either.
That's the trouble. You think what was good enough for the old fifth is good enough anyway.
You really don't think much of me as a big-time politician, do you, Ned?
Oh, I didn't say that, Paul. I said I think you let yourself get outsmarted this time. And mostly because you got itchy over a blonde with social position and
whatnot.
So now you figure...
Cut it, Ned!
Well, I'll be going.
Oh, wait, Ned.
Take your hand off me.
Oh, look, we've been friends for a long time. Like, oh, don't be a fool, Ned. You and I...
Really ought to push your face in for that. You're a crazy character, Ned.
Yeah. I guess I am.
Come on, let's have a beer. I'll have him send up a couple of sidles.
Another one, Chad?
No.
Look, boss, why don't you let me give him the business?
Shut up.
Hey, but Chad, this is the last place we got left in town. It's Pee-wee. We gotta do something.
Knock him off in the election, we can do plenty. That'll hit him where he lives.
Yeah.
Whiskey.
Yeah?
You got any idea where Beaumont hangs out?
Sure, but he's blowing town.
He might be persuaded to stay if we went after him just right.
We'd have to work fast.
Thinking how to put it to him. Jeff.
Huh?
Get Hinkler, the Observer, on the phone. Whiskey.
Yeah.
Take a run over to Beaumont's place. Tell him I want to have a talk with him. Put it this way.
Hey, I get it. Well, thanks for the dope, Jack. Look, do the police know about it yet? Uh-huh. We'll try and find out. Yeah, they got the quicker the better.
Mr. Beaumont?
That's right.
May I come in?
Why not?
I wasn't sure whether you'd see me or not.
Why shouldn't I?
Paul gave me the idea you didn't have much use for me.
I haven't got much use for Senator's daughters on principle. I haven't seen you.
Does that make a difference?
Might. It's a little soon to tell.
I hope you will like me.
Oh? Why?
Well, you're Paul's best friend. At least he feels that way. And naturally, that makes me want you to feel the same way about me.
That'd be impossible. To begin with, you're a woman.
You don't like me so far. That's not hard to see.
Well, now, I'll tell you what makes you think that, Miss Henry. You see, Paul, picked me up, as you might say, a couple of years ago out of the gutter. And I'm sort of clumsy and awkward when I'm around people like you of another world entirely, you know,
roto sections and society columns and all. And so you mistake that gaucherie for enmity, which it isn't at all.
You're ridiculing me.
Isn't it mutual? You pretending to want me to like you because I'm a friend of the man suspected of murdering your own brother?
Did he?
There's a lot of evidence against him.
I know. Is he actually in danger?
If he loses the election, they'll electrocute him.
But he's safe if he wins.
Sure.
Will he win?
I think so.
And if he does, it won't matter how much evidence there is against him.
He won't be tried. I guess that's what you want to know, isn't it?
Yes.
Of course, if your brother had lived, it might have been a different story.
It probably would.
Did you know that someone had been using his typewriter since he died?
I don't think I understand.
Someone has been writing a lot of letters to the DA, the Observer, and others. I've had three myself in the last 2 days.
Oh, that. I guess everyone's had one or two.
Yes, fortunately, the police don't know who wrote the letters.
But you do.
Yeah, I know. Very few people had access to that typewriter. There's only one person it could have been. You wrote the letters.
I guess I'm not much good at lying. You see, I know Paul killed Taylor. I wrote the letters.
That's what I said. Judith herself. You didn't mind teasing Paul as long as he paid off in political backing for your father.
You think I hate him, don't you?
Yeah.
You're right.
Begin to get why you came here. You've been listening to all the local gossip. You figured that I had it in for Paul, too, because of the fight we had. Enough to help you put a knife in his back.
I was wrong.
Yeah, you were wrong. I'd still be Paul's friend no matter who he killed. The thing I don't get, though, is why you didn't go to your father unless you figured he wouldn't split with Paul, even if he knew he was guilty, not till after the election anyway. Well, that's a comforting thing to know.
I suppose you'll relay this to Paul just as soon as I've gone.
Yeah, I might. What would you like me to do?
Say nothing.
Well, I can't promise. But I would like to see you again.
I might like that, too. You're quite different from what I expected.
So are you. Might give you a ring sooner than you expect.
I won't mind.
Oh, hello, Whiskey.
Is this one of Paul's men? Did you put him there?
No. And you'll have to take my word for it now. All right, come on, listen. Come on. Grab yourself a seat.
You and Paul must have had a real split.
That's what they're saying.
Muscling in on his women kind of confirms it.
All right, cut it. What'd you come here for?
Well, Shad thought you and him might have a little talk.
What about?
Thought you might do a little business together.
I don't think so.
Couldn't you be wrong?
Oh, sure. I once was. That was a long time ago, though.
You're trying to kid me, Ned.
No.
Look, Shad knows you and Paul broke up because you were against closing Shad's joints. So you're sitting pretty with Shad right now.
So?
In spite of the joints being closed down, Shad's dough heavy. He's willing to lay it out in chunks to beat Madby.
Well,
you're pretty to get yourself a slice of.
It wouldn't do any harm to talk about him.
Okay. Turn on your diapers and we'll go.
Where's he holding out?
Hit Carson's. I got a car outside.
Let's go then.
I got Hinkle, boss. You want to talk to him?
I'll keep him downstairs. I'll call him when I want him. Place clear?
All but the boys. Rocco's on the door. I'll see who that is. It's Whiskey with Mr. Beaumont now.
Show them in. Well, glad to see you, Beaumont. Put your hat and coat anywhere.
Thank you.
Now.
Okay.
I owe you something for trying to talk Paul out of...
No, you don't owe me anything. I was with him then. What I told him was for his own good. I thought he was making a bad play. Paul thinks that he gave you your start. You ought to stay under his wing, not grow too big to buck him.
I'm just the boy that'll make him sorry he ever gave me that start. You and Paul have been close as a couple of fingers for a good many years now. You ought to know a lot of things about him.
I do.
Things I could use?
Make your proposition.
Well, one thing I can offer you is a chance to pay Paul back. Plenty.
Oh, that's nothing to me. As far as I'm concerned, we're quits.
You wouldn't want to do anything to hurt him, huh?
Oh, I wouldn't mind hurting him, but I can do that any time I want, on my own. You're offering me nothing when you give me that chance.
Why did he bump off young Taylor Henry?
Take it easy. You haven't made your proposition yet.
How does this strike you? After election, I'll stake you to the finest gambling establishment in the state with all the protection you ever heard of.
That's an if offer, if you win.
Oh, you don't think we're going to, huh?
You wouldn't bet even money on it.
You're not so hot for putting in with me, are you, Beaumont?
Well, it was no idea of mine. I'm here to listen.
I'll give you 10 grand now and 10 after election if you come in. And the house offer is still open if you can nail him to the mast on the Taylor Henry killing.
Maybe. Maybe not. Fact is, I haven't enough evidence to stand up in court. If anyone had seen him, it'd be different, but we don't even know he was there. Don't know what weapon he used.
Well, maybe we can help you out a little bit there. Go ahead, Whiskey, tell him.
Well, I was driving along China Street that night. Just happened to see Taylor Henry having an argument with a guy. By that time, I was past him, but I figured something might be up, so I came back around Elm Street. Paul was in quite a sweat by then. Had a stick in his hand. He was waving it around, but good.
Sure it was Paul?
Who else?
Well, in that case, I think we might be able to make it stick.
Fine. I'll hink off the observer, get it in shape.
Maybe.
Well, you want to see the 10 grand first, huh? Quite right. Hey, Juan. Hinkle's downstairs. Get him.
Well, fine. We'll go over to my place and get to work on it.
No, Mr. Beaumont. It'll have to be done here.
Oh, well, if it's the money you're worried about, why, you hang on to it until I've turned in the stuff.
Oh, I'm not worried. You're in kind of a tough spot. If Paul ever found out you'd come to me. I wouldn't want you bumped off before we get the story.
Well, now, that's a chance you're going to have to take. So I'm going.
No, you're not, Mr.
Beaumont. Yeah, yeah. And this is the last time I hand these back to you. Till.
You would have it.
Yeah. Yeah. It'll take some more of it to keep me from getting out of here.
That could be arranged.
Yeah.
You two work him over a bit. I'm going downstairs for a fresh beer.
Yes, Senator. Yeah, I know. Yes, I heard that Ned Beaumont was seen in one of Shadow Rory's cars. No, I'm not worried about it, but I can't believe that Beaumont would throw in with Shad. I tell you, Senator, I'll get the boys out and have them comb every joint in town. But you see, Shad's been undercover for 5 days now. It may take some time to locate him. Yup. Yeah, I know, Senator. He's my man, all right. Yeah, that's right. It's in my lap.
Did I try to snap him out of it?
No, I'll let him alone. Maybe he'll try to get out again and we'll have some more fun. Deal of cards.
Croak him yet?
You can't croak him. He's tough. A tough baby. Every time he comes to, he starts something all over again.
Leave him alone. I don't want him killed yet. You two look all in. Go downstairs and get yourselves a beer.
I could use something stronger than a beer.
Lock the door, dear.
Yeah.
As part two of The Glass Key on Studio One comes to a close, let's look at our Westinghouse program again. How to dry clothes in the rain.
It's no problem at all. Just forget about the weather. If it's raining in the spring or snowing in the winter, for every day is a perfect drying day with a Westinghouse laundromat. It's as easy as this. I take the clothes from the laundromat, all snowy, clean, and fresh now, and without taking a step, I put them in the clothes dryer. No lugging heavy baskets, no hanging clothes up or taking them down. Now, if you want your clothes ready for ironing, just set the dial at damp, dry. That eliminates hand sprinkling. If you want your clothes, if they don't have to be ironed, say things like bedspreads, towels, work clothes, set the dial at dry. And immediately your clothes are tumbled in clean, fresh air until they're fluffy, soft, fluffy, dry. And then your Westinghouse clothes dryer shuts itself off automatically. And look at the results. Now here are six towels dried outdoors. And here are six towels dried with your Westinghouse clothes dryer. They're thirstier, fluffier, softer. And so you see, your Westinghouse twins, your laundromat, and your clothes dryer save time, save money, and save you work. And remember, buy on proof.
Yes, buy on proof. Just phone me, and I'll be glad to show you the many exclusive advantages of the Westinghouse twins, while your own clothes are washed and dried at no cost. No obligation whatsoever.
Westinghouse welcomes you to the third part of its premier presentation of Studio One. We now continue with part three of Worthington Miner's production of The Glass Key by Dashiell Hammett.
All right, peekaboo, but don't you think you're a little old for that?
No wonder people beat you up.
I just wanted to see if you were awake. You have some visitors.
Well, I don't want to see them. You tell them I'm asleep.
It's Mr. Madvick and Miss Janet Henry, the senator's daughter.
Oh, are you impressed by a senator's daughter? Now, why is it is always a senator's daughter, never a representative's daughter or an alderman's daughter? Do you suppose senators are more prolific than other people?
You're not really funny. It's just the way you comb your hair.
All right, let him in.
You can come in now.
Thank you.
Oh, it's good to see you, Ned. We'd have been in sooner, but that doctor is worse than a cop. How are you feeling, son?
I'm all in one piece.
Oh, Ned, excuse me, I was forgetting. This is Janet.
Hello, Mr. Beaumont. And don't blame Paul for this. I made him bring me. I wanted to meet you.
Well, I'm glad you did, Miss Henry. I've been wanting to meet you, too. Grab a chair.
Oh, here. There you are,
Janet.
Thank you.
What did they use on you, Ned? Lead pipe? It is all a blank. I went in there to lay a trap for the gent, and he entrapped me. Who found me and when?
Well, a taxicab driver saw you crawling all over an alley up to 3 a.m. in the morning, leaving a trail of blood behind you.
I think of funny things to do.
I guess I owe you a new head.
Oh, forget it. I use them up too fast.
Paul says with half a head, you can outsmart anyone he ever met.
Well, a man says a lot of things he doesn't mean at a funeral, too.
Oh, Paul can only stay a minute, Mr. Beaumont. I know he didn't want to tell you, but it's something important, I'm sure.
Oh, what?
It's McLaughlin, Ned. He called me just before I started over here, says he's got to talk to me right away.
Oh, the railroad crowd?
Yeah.
Well, you'd better go there.
But I haven't anywhere to go. Would it tire you too much, Mr. Beaumont, if I stayed a few minutes?
No, not a bit.
Oh, good. That's fine. Give you two a chance to get to know each other better. Ned, how far do you think I ought to go with this McLaughlin? The first time, I mean.
Well, as far as you want to go, as long as you don't put it in plain words. They scare him. But you could hire him to commit murder if you gave him a lot of double talk.
Well, we don't want any murders, but we do need that railroad vote. I wish you were up, Ned.
I will be tomorrow.
Good. Anything I can get you, son?
No, unless... unless you'd like to take Miss Peekaboo along with you. You know, someday somebody's gonna design a nurse's uniform that a man can bear to look at. Black satin. Cut down to here. He'll make a fortune.
I'll see you both later. Have a nice visit now.
Bye, Paul.
Goodbye.
Bye, Paul. Did I play it straight enough?
You did all right.
How are you really? You look pretty terrible.
No, I'm all right.
Sure you don't want me to go and let you rest?
Well, my jaw aches a little bit yet, but I can always listen. Suppose you begin by telling me how you felt the first time Paul kissed you.
It was disgusting.
Oh, he has kissed you then, huh? I just wanted to be sure.
Well, now you know.
You know, even if I could prove to you that Paul didn't kill your brother, you'd still hate him, wouldn't you?
Yes, I think I should.
Yeah, that's too bad. You talk this over with your father? If Paul killed your brother, your father knows it.
Of course my father knows, but he's too much of a gentleman to turn on someone
who's... Yeah, well, that's the difference. I'm not a gentleman. I'm a gambler and a politician's hanger-on. So, if you can convince me that Paul's guilty, I'll turn on him and take him apart.
Is that a promise?
Yeah, that's a promise.
What sort of proof do you need?
Well, suppose you begin by telling me exactly what happened the night that your brother was killed.
Well, it was the first time Paul had come to dinner. Taylor was so angry at Dad for having him, he refused to come to the table. Poor Taylor. He always looked on me as sort of a pure spirit. After dinner, Dad left Paul and me alone for a moment. That was when Paul tried to kiss me. I was doing my best to swallow my disgust when Taylor came in. I've never seen anyone so pale in all my life. I saw there was going to be trouble, so I ran out to get Dad. He told me to go upstairs, that he'd smooth things over. But he didn't. The row went on in the hall while Paul took his coat and hat and started to leave. After he'd gone, Dad tried to quiet Taylor down, but he broke away and ran out after Paul. An hour later, I was in bed reading when Dad came in trembling and said that the police had just called to tell him Taylor was dead. Is that proof enough for you?
No. You're putting two and two together and guessing it makes four. If Paul killed your brother, it was no accident. I've seen him fight and I fought with him. He doesn't lose his head in a fight.
I know. You're Paul's friend and it hurts.
Am I? Well, that just goes to show that you haven't the slightest idea what thoughts are going on in my head at this moment. I warned you I wasn't a gentleman. Maybe you do something to me that
Makes it more apparent than usual.
For no good reason I can think of, I'm glad.
So if Paul's guilty, there's only one good way to prove it. He's got to be forced into a confession.
He never would.
No, not to anyone but me.
You wouldn't do it to him.
I might. For a price.
Name it.
I'll think it over.
I'm sorry, but Mr. Beaumont must rest now.
Oh, yes, of course. I'm just leaving. Goodbye, Mr. Beaumont.
Goodbye, Miss Henry.
Thank you. No, now you have to make it. All right,
now hold it steady. I got one little score to settle, and then I'll sleep like a baby. Say, what do you generally do nights?
Go home.
I can't make a better suggestion. Hello? Oh, Jack.
What is it, Jeff?
Can I ask your advice, boss?
What about?
I'm in trouble, boss.
What is it this time?
If I'll go up again, boss, it's life. You know that, don't you?
Suppose I know it. I'm taking care of you, aren't I?
I don't know. Are you?
Makes sense. How much you been drinking?
Plenty. Because I'm scared, see? I just heard somebody tipped off the police. It was me gave Ned Beaumont that going over.
If anyone did, it was Beaumont.
It's not the way I heard it. I heard it was somebody else.
What?
And if I get my hands on the guy, I'm gonna make him squeal like a pig.
I don't blame you.
And I know who the guy is, too.
Yeah? Who?
I'm talking to you, Shad.
What?
Don't take your hands off the table, Rory, and don't try to reach for no rod.
Say, what is this? I got right on one of my own boys?
Yeah, but not again. Not ever again. Ow! Yeah, ow!
So, when I heard the news about Shad, Ned, I figured you had your hand in it somewhere. Now, don't get fooled into thinking this leaves you sitting pretty, Paul, because it doesn't. The boys may not be able to slip over to Aurora anymore, but they're slipping just the same. If Taylor Henry's murder isn't cleared up, Prado, you're sunk. Shad or no Shad.
You think I did it, don't you, Ned?
No. No, and I never have, but I'm about the last person left who believes you. One of Shad's boys is even willing to take the stand to identify you.
Who?
Whiskey. He said, he was going by in a car and saw you arguing with Taylor. You were waving a stick, he said.
Did he say he saw me hit him?
No, but he saw enough.
No, there must be an out, Ned.
There's none unless you clear yourself.
But I can't. I did it, Ned.
I still don't believe it. You never carried a stick in your life.
No, but he did. It was an accident, Ned. He came at me waving a heavy black stick. I still don't know how it happened, but in trying to get it away from him, I hit him, and he fell.
What happened to the stick?
I burned it.
Why? You had to clear out on a self-defense plea.
But I didn't want that, Ned. I want Janet Henry more than I've ever wanted anything in my life, and what chance would I have then, Ned, even if it was an accident?
More chance than you got now. She's always thought you did it. She hates you, Paul. She's trying her best to ride you to the electric chair. Why do you think she stayed in my room the other day? And it wasn't the first time either.
Enough, Ned. What is it? Do you want it for yourself? Is that it? It doesn't make any difference now, anyway. This is the kiss off. Get out of here, you hear?
Get out when I'm through talking.
You'll get out when you're told. You haven't said anything I believe. And you never will now.
And that's that? Sorry, I'm late. They let you in all right, huh? Well,
I guess you win. Paul confessed to me last night.
I won't pretend I'm not glad. And now you know I was right. Paul did kill Taylor.
That's what he told me. It was an accident.
It was murder. Of course he'd say it was an accident, self-defense. Obviously, if it were, he'd have confessed long ago.
No. He kept silent because of you. He's in love with you.
You're sorry for him. You're going to keep quiet, too.
I've just come from the DA's office. I gave him the full story.
Then it's over. Oh, Ned.
Oh, brother. What a spot Paul would be in if you loved him as much as you hate him. No, it's not over. It's one thing for me to say he told me. It's another for him to say it in court. If he chooses to call me a liar, there still is no case.
What can we do?
Look, Janet, I promise to help you, and I will. If I can get the positive proof that we need, do you promise to accept the facts no matter how they stack up?
Yes.
And it's a bargain.
I know you think I'm a monster. Perhaps I am.
I only hope you like it when you get it.
I wish I had a key to open up your head and see what goes on inside.
Be careful. Might be a glass key and break into splinters in your pretty little fingers.
May I kiss you? I've wanted to for a long time.
I'd rather wait till I have only one thing on my mind.
What's the other thing?
Well, it's two things, really. First, has your father a cane or a stick, one with a bone handle?
Well, yes, I think so.
You seen it lately?
Well, yes, I think I saw it just yesterday in the umbrella stand.
Good, good. Now, listen carefully. Because one slip at this time, and both of us can be sunk. I want you to get that stick and bring it to me here this morning. No one must see you take it. Is that clear?
That shouldn't be hard.
Second, and this is a lot tougher. I want you to get your father to take you to call on Paul tonight at his club. Don't give Paul any warning. Just drop in and stay there until I arrive.
That isn't going to be so easy.
No. None of it's going to be easy.
But you'll be there?
Yeah. I'll be there.
Have you only one thing on your mind now?
It's all yours, Senator.
You mean I win again?
That's right.
I'm running in quite a bit of luck this evening. Well, I'll tell you, is $10 too much?
No, I think we might be able to find someone to fade you.
Good.
Ned Beaumont is coming in. If Paul sees him, there's going to be a lot of unpleasantness.
Let me handle him.
Well, hello, Harry. Paul in?
No.
Senator Henry in?
Why?
Well, I got a call a little while ago asking me to meet him here. What are you trying to do? Take away all his dough before the election?
No, as a matter of fact, he's been cleaning me out.
Oh, don't let Paul catch you. Good evening, Senator. How's it going?
Hello, Beaumont. I'm having a disgraceful run of luck, I'm afraid.
Well, I hate to drag you away, but Janet's upstairs with Paul, isn't she?
Yes.
Well, shall we go up? It won't take long, I'm sure.
As you wish. I'll be back, gentlemen, give you a chance to win back some of this money. What is it, Beaumont? Janet seemed very upset.
Something's come up, Senator, that could ruin your whole campaign. Unless it's settled. I'd have kept you out of it if I possibly could.
By all means, let's get it settled then.
I see.
Dad shouldn't stay down there any longer. He knows absolutely nothing about gambling.
He won't lose. Anyway, I wanted a chance to talk to you, Jeff.
Why?
Well, I think it's only fair to tell you that I may be on the skids. Now, I just wanted you to know that so that you couldn't accuse me.
Is the election going badly?
It's more than that, Janet. It's just that... But, yeah, come in. Oh, hello, Senator.
Hello, Paul.
What are you doing here, Beaumont? Nobody asked you here.
I did because I want to hear you say, and I want my father to hear you say what you told Ned last night.
Now, Janet, please, let's not have a scene.
It may be a peculiar interest to you, Senator. You see, Paul confessed to me last night that he killed your son. By accident, of course. There was an argument, and he struck your son with a heavy black stick that your son was carrying. I can give you more details if you want them.
No. That's quite enough.
All right, go on. Get out of here.
No. I want to hear it from you. I want to hear you say it with your own lips.
That you will never hear. All right, Beaumont, you can finish this any way you please, and I hope you enjoy yourself. As for me, I'm going out and get some good, clean air in my lungs.
Aren't you going to stop him?
Why? He won't get very far. He knows his number's up.
Oh, Dad, I know how hard this is on you.
Yes, it is hard. I find it difficult to adjust myself to the knowledge that a man with whom I have worked shoulder to shoulder could have murdered my own son. Now, if you don't mind, I think I'd like to go home.
Not just yet.
You will excuse me, sir?
It's no good, Senator, unless you'd like to hand over the gun that's in your pocket.
Dad!
Oh, I know what you got in mind. You thought it'd be easy to walk out of here and avenge your son's death. They'd never convict you, would they? Well, I'm not going to let you do it.
Ned's right, Dad. You mustn't. You can't.
Take the gun, Jim. Now then, you asked for it and you're going to get it. Paul Madvig didn't kill your son. You did.
Ned.
And now you thought you'd do the same thing to Paul so he wouldn't turn on you. And you knew you had a good chance of getting away with it, too. Dashing gentleman of the old school and
this
all that.
This is sheer nonsense. Paul Madvig has already confessed.
And that's just what's going to send you to the chair. Paul confessed to me that he hit your son with a heavy black stick, which he later burned. He lied. This is your stick, Senator, which Janet borrowed for me. And here's the chip out of the handle. You'll find it fits, because the chip was lying beside your son's head when I found him.
This is more difficult than it should be made for me. I ran out after Taylor that night because I didn't want to lose Paul's friendship through the hot-headedness of my son. I caught up with him on China Street. Paul had taken the stick from him. I asked Paul to leave us alone. And he did so, gave me back my stick. Then Taylor spoke to me as no son should speak to a father. And he tried to thrust me out of his way so that he could chase Paul again. I don't know exactly how it happened, the blow, but it happened. And as he fell, his head struck the curb. Paul came running back then. He hadn't gone far. And we learned that Taylor died instantly. Paul then insisted we leave him there and not admit that we had anything to do with his death. He said no matter how unavoidable the accident was, it would only stir up a nasty scandal in the coming campaign. Well, I let him persuade me. That is what happened.
You let him lie there like that in the street.
Well, it's all over now. I have only one favor to ask. Give me back my revolver. And 5 minutes alone.
No. You'll have to take what's coming to you. All right, Bill. Senator's ready.
You despise me, don't you? You just wanted to show Paul what I was like.
No, no. Whatever you've done, you've paid for.
I suppose now you'll go back with Paul?
No, no. Too much has been said that can't be unsaid. I'm clearing out as soon as the DA lets me.
Does that mean for good?
It does.
Take me with you.
Everybody will say you deserted your father as soon as he was in trouble.
I am deserting him. Why shouldn't they say it?
Oh, Ned. You really still set on clearing out?
Yep.
You really gotta go?
Gotta.
Well, I deserve it, I guess. Whether you go or stay, Ned, I'd like to think that you don't hold anything against me.
I'm not holding anything against you, Paul.
Thanks, Ned.
But there's plenty you can hold against me.
Ah, why,
Janet's
you...
Janet's coming with me.
I've done you a lot of harm, Paul. I always would.
Don't, Janet. Well, luck.
Now go on, get out of here. Both of you, get out.
Is there anything you want before I close up, boss?
Nothing.
Ever make a lemon pie topped with featherlight meringue? Wondered how a few egg whites could make all that fluffy whiteness? Well, here's something new under the sun. A plastic 15 times lighter than the fluffiest meringue you ever saw. Here's how it's made. After the ingredients are mixed, they're poured into this preheated container. In a few minutes, it increases 100 times in bulk, the world's lightest solid. Notice the lightness of this huge mass, enough to completely insulate a Westinghouse refrigerator. This newest product of Westinghouse research may one day insulate your home. More immediately, it holds promise of superior electrical appliances, where insulation against heat must be sure. Another example of the endless drive by Westinghouse to improve its products for home, for business, for industry. You can be sure if it's Westinghouse. Featured in tonight's cast were Don Briggs as Ned Beaumont, Jean Carson as Janet Henry, and Lawrence Fletcher as Paul Madvig. This is Ray Morgan saying goodnight for Westinghouse. You have seen tonight Don Briggs as Ned, Lawrence Fletcher as Paul, Jean Carson as Janet, Les Damon as Shand, Edmund Jerome as the Senator, Sarah Taft as the Nurse, Vern Hoffman as Jeff, Joe Silver as Whiskey, Maurice Gosfield as Harry, and Joseph Latham as Mike. This is Ray Morgan saying goodnight for Westinghouse and hoping you'll be back again next week. Meanwhile, be sure to take advantage of our offer and watch a load of your laundry washed and dried by those Westinghouse twins, the laundromat and the Westinghouse clothes dryer. Call your Westinghouse dealer tomorrow.